I don't know what the date is, 15. Take a minute, 30 minutes, I'll hear a motion. Oh yeah, the official recording secretary cannot be here tonight, so you're on your best behavior, no cussing.
Put that tape on.
It's right there, it's gonna be off of that. Unless somebody wants to, you know.
Well, I usually take some notes of that.
I would say only if anybody makes motions or something, just so we get it straight. Other than that, pish tosh.
Think Kenny's gonna be in this evening?
Maybe. I guess. I don't know what he's doing there. Some kind of CEO stuff. If you think he'd come in here, because there's heat. He's got no heat in his arms. You know, it's too bad that people watching us don't have a rating meter, you know, like they do sometimes. You can just see it go up and down like this, depending on what's going on. I'd love to see ours go like this and then go below zero.
Well, I looked three or four times in the last couple of weeks and never hit. I don't even know if it's play the meeting I missed, so.
Oh.
There was some other meeting I did hit that. We were in,
I never watch it.
October. Well, I wanted to.
You wanted?
I wanted to get up to date.
See what was what. I hear you.
Garrett found it and played it just for me.
Oh, really? I just, you know what? I just didn't play enough.
Did he save it? Did he tape it for you? Did you guys critique it? I think we only mentioned your name in vain a half a dozen times. It wasn't that bad.
So it's been running. I just haven't been awake, or I've only checked a few times.
You've been lucky.
Well, I meant to look up to see if there was a schedule posted, and that just it's my fault. I didn't.
Hey, you didn't hear about the recount yet, did you? Because I thought it was listed in the papers being for him for today.
Right.
And I heard too that already went today.
Bill picked up more votes. He won.
Really?
Really?
Wow. I'll be switched.
Picked up extra votes in Sanford. Mm.
Sanford.
I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes from the room first.
Super. Second. Any changes, corrections, questions, comments? All right then. All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay. That is good. So. Did everybody get a chance to peruse the LID manual booklet? I mean, I can see this, you know, being an aid for code enforcement and for people that may need to use some of these practices. But as far as, I don't know, as far as us doing anything official, like, you know, I don't know. I don't see anything in this that we would incorporate in our ordinance, per se. I think if this is just a tool that shows you all these different LID practices, you know?
Yeah, it's nice to know what, as in the minutes, you know, what what people are going to be paid for, what the practices are actually going to be when we're referring to them.
Yeah, I see.
By knowing the exact practices, you can assess, you can know how much they're worth, for one thing, so it seems to have, it makes it more...
Right, they do give you a cost estimates on installation.
Yeah, it's hard to visualize. I mean, it's not like I read it cover to cover, I just kind of went through the headings and...
What? You didn't commit it to memory? Uh-oh, what, you didn't bring yours here?
It's okay, but it's better than I thought.
Oh, you know, I didn't check out, is there anything in those folders over there? Oh, just this stuff?
Yeah.
Fair mail from some flatter.
I have to go through the blackout, I decided, I'll print it. I read it through the blackout.
Yeah.
Oh, is this? Looks like, Tom's house. National Stormwater Center presents,
Oh, I sent you this.
Did you put a guy, did you pay for it too?
Yeah.
Well, you're a buddy.
I sent another one, there you go.
Come on, cheaper twice the price, and it's online too. All right, so. Back to stormwater then.
Do you have to take this, Ken?
Yeah, I printed it for you guys.
No, do you have to take it?
If I had the $1,000 in my budget, well. It doesn't seem worth it as an online class. I think, was that half a day or a full day? I think there was a couple of them in there.
11 to 1 and then 2 to 5.
Yeah, so it seemed expensive for just a few hours.
Yeah.
And basically it's, yeah, it's for inspectors. It's not necessarily for regular Joes. Go to bed.
Yeah, I thought it was interesting to read a little bit about the pervious pavement. I didn't know that much about it in the LID manual here.
Yep. Yeah, I think this is something that, you know, would be good for Kay to have. To be able to, you know, point out to, you know, various applicants. You know.
You would hope there's new documentation, something a little...
More recent?
More recent.
No, this stuff seems pretty, the practices are pretty much, you know...
The same.
You do this, you do that, here's a rain garden, here's how you do this, that's pretty much the same. I would think the one thing that might change would be, maybe the cost of, you know, designing and then fabricating, because we are talking 07, so that's,
yeah,
you know, 5 years ago.
Yeah, hopefully some of these geoblocks and all that stuff, as they get more used in the market, expands the price for finish.
Someone told me Genesis carries just about everything we need.
Do they really?
Yeah.
I mean, it's happening on the shore. Mm-hmm. Everyone's improving their driveways, and I think they have to do it. It's kind of like putting in septic. I think they have to do it if they want to do other things.
Oh.
Either way, it's in practice in other places.
Well, is there anything that, you know, anybody want to flay this thing, or you want to just get back to the stormwater JT's document and see, you know, how we are with that?
Keep plugging away at that document.
Well, that'd be my guess, I guess. Unless y'all want to go home. Let's get our brain off. cable man's got better things to do. Watch us turn pages.
Hard to say.
Yes. Did we ever define parking lot in that front page?
I think we decided to look like books there, right?
Ooh. Well, that's, I know that's all the rest of our stuff was.
Draft two.
And it's not in, it's not in that. Did? Did we ask JT about this? Because I know we had him hit up a couple of things. We got impervious surface retaining walls,
It doesn't show up in the updated one.
And that's the one from the 13th September?
Yeah. I don't know if we did it in pencil or pen or something, and then I just didn't get it down, but I wrote down the term and then never got to what it was.
I know we had a decent little discussion about it. Where the hell did it come up?
I don't know. No, I see where you have it.
Page, top of page five, I guess,
by the same. I'll shoot parking and loading requirements.
What's that? Oh, wait a minute.
Yeah, we can talk about it in minutes.
Mm-hmm. Well, we talked about geoblocks.
Talked about what?
Geoblocks, right?
Mm. No, but I thought either we will just go with it as a. As a common term that people know what it is, or else we get JT actually came back.
Well, we've got a definition for a parking space.
It was just parking area we were unclear with, and I think we just thought it would be similar enough to parking space. So that's what I remember, but I don't know.
I mean, does it need clarification?
I don't know. Like I said, I just have it here in this one, I have it here in this one, and I don't have anything other than in parentheses the word definition.
You know, I think on page five here, it looks as if it's talking about something other than a home, you know? Like, the one example they use is a boat launch. You know, you need a place to park vehicles right near the shore. And then B says, parking area should be adequately sized for proposed use. You know, so I suppose if it's a single family home, you get a couple of spaces and that's it. And that's all you would need. So I don't think it's any...
What if you have a place that had a marina? Is there any of the lakes in town that have a marina?
Not anymore.
Just off the one you screen square?
Yeah. Is that even a marina anymore? It's a Shapley anyway, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think we've got any marinas on the lakes anymore. I don't think they're inactive.
And what about the store down here?
What about it?
So the parking lot comes into play there.
Right, but that's all grandfathered. And... I don't know.
If they went to change it, it might give us purview to suggest some of these other techniques, right?
It might, but my guess would be the state would probably be right on top of it as well.
Yeah, it's
they've got gas there, it's a business.
Yeah.
And all roads lead to the water there, and they're all paved, so.
Yeah.
I don't know what all, yeah.
And they just did redo it, didn't they?
Well, they did redo it. We did the gas stuff and all that, and they did.
This is a roof over it now.
Over what?
Over the gas pumps.
Yeah, right.
They used to be out in the open floor.
But as far as I think they did repave the lot too.
Somewhat.
Which just means that the water just goes
really fast.
Faster than
the lake. Yeah.
You can. I've seen guys take canoes in a big storm down that ramp. You know, it's like rapids. Those are the same guys that ride their snowmobiles in the winter under the bridge. Anyway.
After we adjourn, we'll have to meet to tell the story.
I thought we were adjourned!
I have a good acting trivia story.
Oh, not for the cable people, huh? All right, so are we fine with just leaving the parking area as what it is? And we've got a definition in our book as far as space. And, I mean, generally if a word's used in the ordinance and we don't have a specific definition, then we just go by whatever Webster says. And I don't even know if Webster has a definition for a parking area. Maybe they do.
You happy? Next question.
Okay, so we just all have to make a note of what our...
What's the next
question? Right, we're all writing down, so you have to ask this question again.
Go ahead. What's your next one?
Next question, page 6.
Ooh, good.
And it's the list of all the ponds. I guess my question is, the numbers that are associated with each of those lakes, one, are they ever updated? Two, if so, how often? Or is this the numbers that goes on, like, forever?
My guess would be they're probably, well... I'm pretty guessing. Hey, these numbers here on page 6.
I just are eating on the phosphorus levels, right?
Yeah.
Do they ever change? Did somebody ever come in and say, okay, we're going to use this number now for this
one? No, I think it's the baseline they're working from. So that's not supposed to change. That's the minimum standard.
Down the line, though, if a water body was became more impaired, they might change the standard a little bit.
Right.
Possibly, right, if you know.
So you're thinking maybe we should throw something in, use these numbers or the latest?
No.
Because if we've got these numbers in the ordinance, then they're locked in until we would have the town meeting vote on changing it.
Yeah.
But if we threw in some disclaimer that...
You gave yourself a little leeway.
And, you know, the way it's printed out here, it's tough for me to read this thing anyway. Main deep people are acre phosphorus at Eastern Shore Lake. Watersheds?
Yeah.
What's that word?
Yeah, watershed.
Watershed?
So.
Lake watershed, it's impacting the...
Yeah, we'd have to maybe put an asterisk somewhere and say the most current main DEP per acre allocation numbers shall be used when available. Somewhere, we put that somewhere under D.
Following table.
But something we might have to do too, just go back to the ordinance in 10 years if there has been a change in, or whatever the time period is, and put it in our ordinance so that it's there for people.
Yeah, I like the idea of putting a reference in to where that information specifically comes from. So that anyone who wants to question the source can go to it.
Well, it says main DEP per acre phosphorous allocations.
Okay, that might
so
be
my guess would be...
That might be enough just to...
Yeah, it's going to come from the DEP in Maine. Now, is it... Go ahead.
Maybe after the last... After the colon on under B, where it says following table and then there's a colon, you could have in parentheses... as updated allocation numbers are issued by main DEP, they will be utilized as developed or something. Let's squeeze them one out of there. Or just most current. Phosphorus allocation numbers.
Periodic updating?
Yeah, something like that. Or as new numbers become available. How do we know we'll do that? There's a boilerplate sentence for that.
Yeah.
established.
You could say, please check DEP website for updates.
We're probably better off, if we're gonna do something, throwing it right in here. Oh, I shouldn't find my table. Maybe we should say something like, these are the most current.
These are updated as of 2013.
Yeah, I mean, we don't know now when these numbers came.
Well, I wonder what would be the problem if some of these were updated down the road and we had to wait till a town meeting. I mean, you know, unless you're gonna get some 100-unit subdivision right on, you know, on the lake with everybody having a beach, I don't know that it's gonna make that big a difference, you know? You know, we're talking maybe a handful of homes. And if the minimum were lowered, it's, you know, I don't know that it's something we really need to worry about. If they change, then we just, then we change it.
Could we make a note to be revised by planning board in 2030? In the future, 2008, I was gonna say 5 years. Just so we have a mental note somewhere in the ordinance. 2018 or something.
I mean, everything could be revised by, and you know, everything we do, we end up taking a look at it and making changes. We may end up changing this in a few years for adding something or taking something out. I don't know. I don't care. If somebody comes up with something succinct that we can put in there, fine. If not, does that make it more incomprehensible than it already is?
Well, if you put an asterisk next to that title at the end of Act Main, and then underneath the thing, put the asterisk and say something along the lines of, numbers are subject to DEP
update
approval.
All right, fine.
As new allocation numbers are developed.
Oh, that's money. Numbers are subject to DEP. What was the word begins with a U?
Updating.
That gives us license to basically, when new numbers.
They're the ones making the call.
Right. But that would give us license, or Kenny license, as new numbers are developed for X pond, they can be utilized without.
What was that sentence again? Numbers are.
Subject.
Oh! Subject to?
To DEP updates.
Oh, good. Simple enough. Numbers are subject.
Well, which is something like that.
No, that's fine. Mm-hmm. Yeah, perfect. Great. Nobody's going to pay attention to it anyway. All right, what else you got there, Bob?
It comes back down to the biggie that we've been going after for the last six.
Parking areas again?
I have a feeling that has something to do with maintaining and dealing with the maintenance deal and all that kind of stuff.
What page? What thing are we looking at?
Page 6A and also page 10, the guarantees.
Page 6A. You mean up top? The applicant shall submit a low impact?
Yeah, maybe I was looking at the other one.
You're not,
yeah, I guess it's
number
5A.
Right.
And then basically it goes back down then to the guarantees under page 10 and how we deal with that.
Oh, okay. So, projects are involving disturbance of land control. Such projects or activities are not required to be solar farms. Our site plan or conditional use review required by the use chart section 2.710. If all the following three conditions are met, A, they're not required to have a DEP stormwater permit. B, such projects involve the service of land requiring code enforcement review and located in the shoreline, commercial B or RP, line less than 100 square feet of impervious, and such projects are reasonably restricted by the... Should be accepted from the standards. They don't require a DEP permit.
Or a conditional use permit, right? Or a site plan.
Right.
Review, yep.
Or they add less than 100 square feet of impervious, which is 10 by 10.
Yeah.
Or they're less than or equal to 2,000. This is what I'm okay. They're less than or equal to 2,000 square feet in area of slopes greater than 15, less than or equal to 10,000 on slopes of 15 or less.
So if it's a little flatter, they're letting 10,000 go.
Yeah.
Steeper slope should max out at 2,000.
So if it's, but they have to meet all three of these things. They can't just meet less than 2,000 feet on a 15% or greater slope.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So. So Bob, what's your problem?
Well, our problem has been over the last few weeks. How do we maintain? How do we know that they're being maintained?
Oh. Well. This isn't talking about maintaining. This just talks about
who qualifies.
Yeah. All right. If you want to talk about this, so then we are looking at what, page 10 then?
Yeah.
Force gonna tease. Hey. Look who's here. The secretary. Come on in. All right. You got a chair right here for you. You're late? That's what happens. That's what you get. Show up on time and you sit wherever you want.
You're a baby. You're the dunce cat for me.
No.
You turn off my phone.
Well, yeah.
I mean, I think that's where we're at. Once we get that straightened out, then...
Yeah, you're right. And what... Did we throw some numbers around?
Checked off the list and just kind of your property would be not checked after that.
But...
You can't do that.
Yeah, but you can't, I mean...
You can sit.
Yeah, it depends on the practices.
Even if a fresh drink needs to be...
We were trying to think of an incentive where you would have an incentive for doing it right. And then, you know, once you kind of prove that you were in the habit, get a reward of not having to continue paying as much.
Yeah, Art had some ideas.
The town has to take responsibility for it. I mean, it's the only way that it's going to... We talked about a line in the budget for whatever expenses are associated with that, whether it's the code enforcement officer or the contractor or somebody.
Could we develop an association, like some kind of umbrella association of associations that would just take care of all the red tape?
So what I learned in my...
Shoreland membership fee and let them work it out?
If you give somebody responsibility, you also have to give them authority. Can't have responsibility without authority.
Well, yeah, but
came out of the textbook on management.
same person, so same need, group so would have to have that?
Kenny needs to have authority.
Well, that would be the whole idea. They'd collect the fees, they take care of the follow-up and the maintenance. It'd be like an associate. I was thinking like the model of a condo fee, where you pay in, you pay your dues, your garbage goes away for you.
Ultimately, it comes back to the community.
Right.
You can, you know, try and put it
in an
association or a neighborhood or whatever you want to do, but ultimately, it comes back to the town.
Yeah. They'd just be the managers for the town, and you know what I mean? So that you wouldn't have Ken having to hire extra people to do it.
Ken wants to
be run through a...
That's where it's coming anyways. It's just a matter of when we get there.
Ooh. Summer grapes.
I have a suggestion, just thinking about where we ended up in this discussion the last time we met. In the minutes of today, we spoke about a... an LID, shoreland LID fee that would be assessed on permits pulled for activity in the shoreland district to offset expenses relative to initial review and inspection of newly installed systems. What would you think, Kenny, of having a little more fairness in that, maybe, and levy that fee according to the a percentage of permit cost of project? So our friend that we visited the other day on Upper Mousum, if we just set a 10% basis of the permit cost of the project, he would be paying 10% of whatever his permit cost is, and a smaller project would be levied a smaller fee. It would just, I would think it would produce, and we still would go ahead with the notion of a fee, a line in the budget to enable you to do the inspections as that burden becomes larger and the software expenses become more complicated and expensive. We'd still retain that, but I was just thinking that maybe we need to reconsider an issue of fairness in terms of the scope of the projects and that LID fee. I don't know what folks would think of that. As one means to have some fairness in the levying of the fee, respective of the size of the project. It's a given that a larger project is going to incur more costs from your office. And essentially have more impact on the lake, or could have. That's not done right. Any motion on that?
I need to hear some examples of fee costs and how the fees are done. Is it per practice?
Kenny?
Because that's what we were deciding already, was kind of negative reinforcement. You're just going to say, well, you've got five practices on your property, so we pay more.
No, it's not keyed to the number of LID, BMPs, or whatever you want to call them, on site. It has to do with the permit costs that are generated as the application is processed through Kenny's office.
And they're generated per square foot, or?
Cost of construction.
Cost of construction.
$4 per thousand right now, so add a dollar in there, and it'll be 25% or so.
What would the figure, just off the top of your head, of 10% of permit fees, permit costs, how would that come out versus the $100 flat?
It would have been $200 or $300 for that one we did the site work on.
And the gentleman that we saw on Mousum would have, based on what you told us, it would have been $500. 10%
correct.
And on a small little project, if the fellow was just going to put in a rain gun or something, it might be as small as $10 or $20.
Mm-hmm. Well, no, but a rain garden is, I don't get how you attach the rain garden to the cost of construction.
I'm just saying, that it's not so much the rain garden, it's the fact that the fellow has to come in and get a permit through Ken's office, and for that, I don't know what permit a guy would need to do something like that. Conditional use permit in the shoreline zone or something?
Correct, and probably a DEP permit, but somebody installing a rain garden really isn't the issue here. It's somebody being required to install a rain garden is the issue, or the LID.
I thought we were talking about the maintenance and then the inspections of these.
Correct, but if he puts one in, I don't want to say nobody's on a can, but if he's required to put one in, that's when we're going to, it's a bigger issue.
Right, but if somebody has a let's say they have a rain garden design, does it always come with an operation and a maintenance schedule as well? Because if it's got a maintenance schedule, then we would know what each one of these things, whoever designs it, every 2 years this should be checked, every 5 years this should be checked. That should be part of the plan to begin with. That each of these, that way, you know, you'll know whoever's going to check on these exactly what needs to be addressed and when.
I thought that was in the model. It is, yeah.
Well, it just says
a bit about maintenance on each.
Yeah,
each
it
one
says there should be one, but it doesn't say exactly what it is. But
no.
Whoever draws the plans up, if we require, and I don't know that we necessarily do in our proposed ordinance. I don't know if we require an operation and maintenance plan. You know, with whatever LID they're going to use. I think if we incorporate that.
In the model, on
no, I'm talking about the ordinance, not this thing. I'm talking about, do we require it in the ordinance somewhere?
Well, it may. I don't know if it's spelled out in the ordinance.
All this says is
if you had an application form wherein it was spelled out that you needed to have a plan submitted, and a description of the responsible body for ensuring maintenance occurs, or you know, method that Ken can sign off on.
Right, but I think we ought to require that in this. Anybody doing an LID must also include an operation and maintenance plan.
I think it is.
It is.
But
I missed it if it is.
If you're installing something add to the price of construction and therefore the cost of the permit to begin with?
Yeah.
Okay, so they're already paying more for their permit.
I'm not talking about money.
We were, but that was what the discussion was about, wasn't it?
Yes, yes, yeah. Well, it was part of it, but...
Are you, yeah.
Well, can we just take a small bite of this notion? Is it fair? What is the most equitable way to treat this? If you're going to have a fee, should you have a flat fee across the board for anyone who's doing an LID, as it was called in the minutes, a shoreland LID fee? And we should change the name of that, I think. An erosion control fee or something like that. Is it fair to have a flat rate of that, regardless of the size, scope of project, or would it be more equitable to have based upon permit fees, a percentage of permit fees keyed to the project? I would suggest the latter.
Yeah, me too. Yeah. Because somebody can have a real simple, they would need a real simple LID, and they'd be paying the same amount of a fee that somebody who needs some giant, great, big, you know, tear the world up type of deal.
Yeah. Bottom line is you need X number of dollars, and if you go that first route, somebody down here is going to be paying a heck of a lot more.
Yeah.
To cover, to get to that level.
Yeah, I think it should be some kind of a percentage. But how to figure what that percentage should be.
Aren't they already paying more by doing more? So if they're already doing more, they're already paying more.
Well,
so the flat fee is kind of a separate.
The fee is, what are we charging this fee for?
For what,
right.
Time and
exactly.
During construction and also for at least maybe an inspection or two, or no? We're just paying for his time during the construction?
Well, I don't know. You guys discussed it 2 weeks ago. I wasn't here.
It's in the minutes, Chip. Under three, item three discussion.
Right. I'm just trying to, where does it say?
To offset expenses relative to initial review and inspection of newly installed systems.
All right, fine.
So there would be a pre and post inspection.
All right, so I would think the bigger a deal, the more involved an LID you have, the more time and money it's going to cost the town to oversee it.
Is that already covered by the fact that it's $4 per square foot of... or something? Aren't you already paying? I mean, I don't know. If it counts outside, does the landscaping count? Or is the permit?
Usually not.
Okay, so that would be the question. Should it or not?
No. And I mean, the end result is you want as many of these LIDs installed. You don't want to prevent them, slow them down, discourage them.
Well, if we have the ordinance, if they would have to do something, they would have to do it. It's not like they can opt out and say, oh, I'm not doing any LIDs.
No, you may have people installing these anyways that don't need to install them. They have an issue on their property and they want to maintain it and dispose of the stormwater into the ground, get it into the ground.
Right.
But you
still... Oh, and if we charge a sliding scale fee that may deter them from doing that?
Yeah. I mean, there's two aspects of it still, I think, is the people that are required to install these and maintain them, and then the people that just install them because they want to.
Well,
the people that have been doing it the last 3 or 4 years.
Maybe we can put a proviso in there that if it's required, you're going to pay some kind of a fee, but if you want to do it out of the goodness of your heart, we'll let you, we won't charge you a penny.
Yeah.
So they would need a permit. If they're in the shoreland zone and they're going to do some LID practice on their own, they still need a permit because they're disturbing the ground.
Mm-hmm. They'd be exempt if they were more than 100 feet away from the water now, I think. The shoreland zone goes back 250.
Right. If the building or where the...
Soil disturbance.
Soil disturbance, yeah.
DEP's going to exempt it at 75 feet.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Regardless, though, if they can, if they do it... By instruction of the ordinance or on a voluntary basis. It's the issue of maintenance and initial review pre and post is still there. In some cases, anyway. I mean, I don't know about...
Well, they have to do the maintenance. We're not, the town's not doing that.
I know, but the town, I would think, even on the voluntary ones, would want to ensure that they were still operating.
That they're maintained, yes. Yeah, sure.
So it would take some level of review from Kenny's office to determine that.
So if you have a site that doesn't have to come to a BPL or anything, but it's just, it's a shoreline house, the guy's had some...
Erosion problems.
Erosion problems, and just going to fix it on his own, wouldn't normally, we might come to talk to Kenny to see what he needs. Are you saying all of a sudden he's going to have a permit to correct that erosion problem?
I'm asking Kenny, the question should go to Kenny, does he need a permit?
More than likely, he may need a permit to disturb the soil.
In the shoreline.
And how much would that be, you guess?
$50.
For something like this?
$75.
So he's paying a $50 fee to do an LID?
So he might have to pay another $5 on top of it, a 10%. Community erosion control inspection.
Would that be maintained?
What's that?
Would that be enough to maintain it, $5?
No. The maintenance is the tough part.
But he might cut back on his plans too if he has to pay more. Like where he might have done 3 or 4 LIDs, maybe only do 1 or 2 or something.
Well, how are you going to pay for the inspection of these things?
That's easy. You're just adding a fee to it. It's the maintenance down the road is the tough part.
But that's what he has to do.
But what if he doesn't do it?
And that's where we've got that last then the last page performance guarantees. And
there has to be a means to pop it up on the computer.
No. We're talking about who's going to pay for maintenance. We're not worried about the inspection right now. We're worried about who's going to maintain this if the homeowner decides he doesn't want to after 5 or 6 or 7 years.
I thought Ken had a solution for that to the tune of it would be notification would be sent out saying, you know, X time has elapsed since initial installation. This system is due for maintenance. Can you send us a letter back saying that you performed the maintenance and a signed copy of the contractor who performed the maintenance?
And if they don't and they won't, then what?
Then there's a fee schedule in place that will allow the town to have monies on hand to go on site and do it.
Right.
There has to be something along those lines too.
Yeah, but that's where
having some kind of fund.
That's where we're talking about performance guarantees. Some kind of
lean their property.
Pardon me?
Clean.
Oh.
Yeah. Are we mostly talking like taking sand out of rain gardens? Is that kind of what we're talking
about?
Yeah. Well, the simple things are, yeah. But if you've got, say you've got this, whatever the hell that one thing was, that some kind of funky pre-septic.
Pre-treatment tank.
Yeah, some BS like that. That's going to involve a little bit of expertise. And expertise always equals M-O-N-Y, you know?
I mean, what's the normal thing?
Didn't you guys watch, what the hell was that movie?
So good movie.
No, Dustin Hoffman and John Boyd.
Midnight Cowboy.
That one. You must have seen that.
One of the all-time great movies.
M-O-N-Y, that's I want amazing. My money. No, that was John Boyd with the... That woman. Anyway.
Here we go.
Well, Tom will tell his story after the meeting, and I'll tell this one.
Yeah, he's after the meeting. Kenny, help us out here. I thought we had a crude trail through the woods as to how to do this.
Well, I do remember last meeting that, Kenny, you had the $100 idea, the LID, but you also mentioned that you could easily use up to $100 on some of the projects, and we are going to...
Work, really.
We're going to need more money from somewhere in order to help you with that. You know, like you were saying, you could, you know, just going through the manual with it is going to eat up some money, so...
Yep.
It does seem like something like Tom's suggesting here would be advantageous to bring in that revenue.
So these performance guarantees are just to make sure the thing gets completed. They've got nothing in them for maintenance down the road, you know? And I don't think...
Should we have a separate stormwater permit?
Pardon me?
Should we have a separate stormwater maintenance permit? Sounds like bureaucracy building, but, no. I mean...
No, we can solve this.
One way to...
We felt like we were pretty close last time towards something, you know, seemed like...
Well, it looked like some kind of group funding, like the whole town, which, you know, that's a worth thinking about. You know, do we start a shoreland fund? Still has to get approved and started somehow, and then who's going to maintain that fund?
I understood we couldn't do any kind of funding.
Oh, and you can't roll over monies in that
account.
It's hard to roll over monies, they're saying.
Can we just bill
to the next to the next fiscal year? They like to see them all spent during the 1 year.
Do we
well, that's why if you did it under an association or something,
right.
They could have.
Not really,
right.
It's so, in the fees.
Yeah.
There,
the fee schedule.
There'd be like a maintenance association.
What if it's,
or it would be a municipal one.
Yeah.
Well, in the interest of moving this forward, I'd make a motion that the fee schedule be key to a percentage of permit. I'll just throw a 10% of the permitting. What do you call that package, Ken? Total construction permit fee of the project. And 10% of that cost would be allocated for, or raised and allocated for what it says in the minutes there. For,
add a minimum fee of $100 and then.
And then out from there?
Well, if it, you know, 10% was more than 100. But I mean, I can't imagine. You could not, you could have too little of a fee to cover his time pretty easily.
Yeah.
You know, if it was only, you know, 10% was $20, it wouldn't come close to what you. The cost would be for the code enforcement officer.
If anyone has new Durham's stormwater management control, blah, 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 they've got a whole section here about operation and maintenance plan. And it lays out everything except any kind of fees. And it says failure to implement an operation and maintenance plan. This is by the, this, we should say, homeowner. They're notified three times, and if that doesn't work, then the town is authorized to assume responsibility for the maintenance and to secure reimbursement for associated expenses from the responsible party, including, if necessary, placing a lien on the subject property.
I've read that before.
Yeah, Art? But you said it so quiet. So, this may be something, we may even want to throw this whole, or the majority of this one article here, right into this. Because right now, we've got nothing in here that says you have to have an operation and maintenance plan and that blah, 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 blah. And we get a
well, it says on page 6 out of JT's thing, page 6, it's on the same page as the Foster Standard.
Right.
Under section A at the top.
Yeah.
Failure to maintain LID stormwater management system according to the plan shall be deemed a violation of this ordinance and subject to the provisions of Article 6.
Which, that doesn't
mean administration.
Yeah, but that doesn't...
Well, it's in there. He's got another one too, so... Yeah, we can do it more.
I think the new term thing is, you know, halfway decent, and it's,
section four,
you know, it's like a page and a half, and boom, it's all right there.
Mm-hmm.
Don't we have to get this thing? Go ahead.
I personally find the idea of bonding or your letter of credits or any of that kind of stuff to be onerous. And I'm much more comfortable with if you don't maintain your LID according to as required, this is what's going to happen.
Right. Yeah, I think those performance guarantees, again, are basically for the construction of the project. Because once it's constructed, nobody has a... If these things have to be maintained forever, then how much money are you going to have a homeowner set aside? $1 million? You know, you can't do that. So the performance guarantees are just in place while the thing is being
constructed.
And once it passes its initial inspection, then it's done. After that, the maintenance, whatever maintenance is deemed for the project, gets handled by the homeowner. And if he doesn't do it, and we find out he doesn't do it, then we notify him a few times, and if he doesn't do anything, then we do it, we meaning the town, and he gets the bill. And if he's like that, then we put a lien on him. And we kick his little duff right out of town.
Does Ken need authorization somewhere in language to visit the site post-development for an inspection visit?
I would say, yeah. Yeah, because once the permit's closed off, it would just be need some verbiage in the ordinance that allows continuous inspections.
On a periodic basis.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Now, we didn't address that in here.
Waltzed around.
Subject to the provisions of ordinances.
I mean, as we get into all of this, these specifics and these numbers and the dollars, I mean, the bottom line is we have to get this passed also. I mean, I know the idea is that we're making the lakes better. That's going to benefit everybody in town, but that's sometimes maybe not how people see things initially. All they see necessarily is right away is the fact that their fees are going to be higher. So I'm not saying that we should cut back. I'm just saying maybe we need to make sure that we do this in a way that we get it passed too.
We have to do it with Joe says.
All right, so. So we need provision for Ken to be able to code enforcement to visit the site.
Wait, wouldn't I?
I'm just writing it on a piece of paper.
We're accepting it. Most of us would go signature. It's okay.
And a maintenance plan on file. Maintenance is 500.
Yeah, so we need some way for Ken to be able to go on the site after everything's said and done to make periodic inspections. We also need to have, when they turn in this plan, what it is they're gonna do, we need some kind of operation and maintenance plan along with it. So the town knows when it needs to be inspected and what needs to be maintained on. Is it something simple or is it a big old deal?
This, I think that's where
this. It's pretty standard these days. Large landscape projects and whatnot. So.
Yeah, but see, that's not in the ordinance. I'm talking about, you've got to have it in the ordinance.
There should be mention of it, but I think this is a good model maybe for us to built from.
Well, that's...
For the application form, because it spells...
Oh, yeah.
Spells it right out. Operations and maintenance plan. I had one kind of basic question that goes, is more basic maybe than what we've been putting in. The threshold at which these things are necessary or required. And then the second part of that is who has to write the plan. If we look at page 4, 5.8.1. And then you look in your ordinance at page 14 on the land use chart under other uses, fifth line down. Filling, draining, and other earth moving activity less than 10,000 cubic yards. Yeah, under columns 9, 10, and 11, which is RP, shoreline zone, and Little Ospie in this case, which we're not going to be mixed up with, a conditional use permit is required for filling, draining, and other earth moving activity less than 10,000 cubic yards. So if you put that together with the language in 5.8.1, there isn't a heck of a lot that would escape the necessity to develop a plan, it would seem. The plan seems to be level one of requirements, and then when you go over to 5.2.5, under 4, where they talk about the three items that are eligible to exempt you from the requirements of 4A and B, I don't see how anything would pass that. I don't see how anything would be eligible for that exemption. That may or may not be a bad thing, but I'm just saying, I'm just raising the point for discussion. Excuse me, the exemptions are discussed in the criteria for that on page 6 and 7, under numeral 5, A, B, and C.
Right, Chip read those earlier, yeah.
But the thing that may or may not be a problem is the trigger that is dictated by the definition of filling, draining, and other earth-moving activity less than 10,000 cubic yards in RP or shoreline zone is conditional use. Raises the question whether a related question whether or not a BPL permit is a form of a conditional use permit. I would think that it might be. As a, you know, there's a number of permits that we talk about with specific names, but they are in essence conditional use permits.
Yeah, but they're not. I mean, essence is one thing, but officially,
let's go through these A, B, and C again, looking at the chart just for a second here, because, you know, just what kind of project would be exempt, you know, we'll just try to keep it in mind as we go through it. So the first thing, A, such projects or activities are not required of DEP stormwater permit, nor a site plan, nor a conditional use review. So if they're moving soil in the shoreline zone or in the RP, they're going to need a conditional use review, so that's automatically going to disqualify them. But if they're in commercial B, they can keep going. Then you have B, which is the 100 square of impervious, but they're going to have to do some earth moving in order to get there. And then, I guess if you were still in commercial B, you were making less than 100 square feet of impervious, and you dug some stuff up, that was all right. Then we get down to C, and then you have the two numerical thresholds there with the slope. It really don't seem like a lot of projects could squeeze through just because of the...
Right, right. It's going to encompass just about everybody.
Yeah.
So there, it could be feasible that a small project in commercial B would be eligible for exemptions under that language.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very small.
Right.
Like a parking space.
So well, there would still be the disturbance, areas of disturbance. They'd still have that, you know, less than equal to 2,000 on slopes greater than 15, or less than equal to 10,000 on slopes 15 or less. So as long as they were within that and they were in the commercial B.
Yes, but what was the 100 square foot one?
B. That was B.
Which is
so what did it say? What page is this off?
Page 7.
Such projects or activities include disturbance of land requiring code enforcement officer review and are located in shoreland, commercial B, or resource protection districts,
okay,
and will add less than 100 square feet of impervious surface area to the site.
I got you.
That's kind of the same for your C, too, because there's 10,000. No, it isn't. Yes, it is. 10,000 square feet. Oh, I'm getting confused. 100 square feet is 10 by 10.
Mm-hmm.
10,000 is 100.
100 by 100 is big, yeah.
Yeah.
That number is pretty big for just a shoreline zone, so I was thinking when I looked this over. But...
Yeah, well, I think very few things are going to be able to sneak through.
And that's not necessarily
a bad thing.
A negative. Right. Yeah, it's important for us to get our hands around what we're doing here, I think.
Including the
BPLs,
are you thinking they're
going to
sneak through?
Well, according to the land use chart right here, filling, grading, or other earth-moving activity less than 10,000 cubic yards is a conditional use permit in the shoreline zone, so the best possible location would be a conditional use.
The intent of that is gravel pits, though. The filling, grading, less than 10,000 yards.
Or other earth-moving activity.
Yeah, I know.
It's pretty open. Because the next one down, you know, they indicate that one's definitely mineral extraction industrial, they say.
Well, it might indicate a need to fine-tune the land use chart.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm just pointing out that it's there.
Mm-hmm.
We may need a line that deals specifically with best possible locations or let best possible locations be included as a new line under the items that are, which you plug in, for example, C talk about code enforcement review, so that's a pretty low threshold right there, but maybe it ought to be included under 5A after the word wording nor a site plan or conditional use or BPL review, just so that we're hitting on it somewhere or other.
Isn't the nature of the BPL going to trigger the...
Yes.
The problem is we don't want to get into a semantic problem here, because we haven't used the term, and we would be stretching the term maybe to call it a conditional use. I don't want to, somehow or other we have to define whether or not either a BPL is a conditional use, or, and if it isn't, and we want to include it in this review, it ought to be, the term ought to be used, that's all.
Well, A talks about projects that aren't required to have a DEP permit, or a site plan, or conditional use, or if you want to add best possible location.
That's what I'm suggesting, it might be sensible to put it there. Because by the nature, a BPL seems to involve quite a bit of soil disturbance.
Well, it certainly could, and it's within 100 feet of the water.
But if you're adding BPL into that verbiage, aren't you exempting it?
Well, see, that's what I'm thinking.
If you're putting it in there, these are what's exempt. But I mean, if they're not adding more than 100 square feet of impervious and they're not disturbing more than 2,000 square feet...
Well, it's treating it in the negative, I agree. Mm-hmm. But by mentioning it, if you turn it around and saying, those projects or activities that are required to have a DEP stormwater and a site and or a site plan or conditional use review or BPL review according to the land use chart in section 2.7 shall be, I'm going to turn that on its head just as an example of why we need to use it maybe in that instance.
Well, it is
a
review from the code enforcement officer.
Yeah, you'd catch them under me, I would assume. Because they require a code officer, code enforcement officer. Unless it was very small.
Well, B is, wait a second, I'm confused. If you're talking about five, you're talking about projects that don't come under.
Right, but what I'm suggesting that we need to do is delineate between. I think somewhere in here we have to use the word BPL permit, or best possible location permits, just so that those are included within the review authority of the ordinance. Because the sense of the board seems to be that they are they're not a full blown conditional use permit, and so we have to call them by a different name.
Right, because we don't go through the whole process.
5.25 doesn't 3 cover it? Any new construction or development, redevelopment, enlargement of existing projects, filling or grading of earth moving activities requiring a permit. Okay.
Well, they need a permit to whatever they're going to do with their best possible location. They still have to get a permit because they're...
From the DEP?
Well, no. Does it say... What number are you reading again?
I'm on 5.25.3. But the second part of 4 would do it, too. Because that just says a review from the code officer is required.
Pursuant to the land use chart.
Well, these are all different, these are all separate things.
Right.
They're not talking about the first two lines would require a DEP permit. It's either new construction or development, or redevelopment, or enlargement of existing projects, or filling or grading and earth moving, or something requires a DEP permit. Shall obtain such a permit, present evidence and additions to the CEO prior to commencement of the project. So
yeah, and then it's reinforced.
It's right into there. So if you come to Kenny because you want to do something to your property that's closer, that's within 100 feet of the water, boom, that's review, and that's new construction, new development, new something. So right there it falls into.
So Tom, is that addressing your question?
Yeah. As I read 5253, those criteria that precede the phrase requiring a DP stormwater permit are conditioned by that phrase.
No, they're not. No, they're not. If there was a colon or a second colon, that would be. They're just commas. They're just a list. It's one more thing in the list.
Is it the grading and earth moving activities that require a DEP stormwater?
Yeah, so there's a grammar error in that sentence that needs correction. So well, that it's clear. That's all.
No,
because... But not all these things require a DEP permit.
Time. It's just merely saying the above list of activities, I'm just going to paraphrase this, these following activities, comma, requiring a DEP stormwater permit, shall obtain such a permit.
No, you can't paraphrase it. We're going to find out from JT exactly what he means here. We're not paraphrasing a damn thing. We're going to get it down in black and white, not gray. Black and white. So we'll call JT and find out exactly what he means by this sentence.
Okay.
Unless it came from Forrest Bell.
No, JT had the letter, so we'll ask JT.
Well, he underlined it because it was a new
thing. So our big question is, the big question is, do within 3 and 4, are we absolutely sure that BPLs will always be covered? Is that what you want? Is that what we're trying to get at?
Well, the reason it arises again because of 4, first dot there. These are the items not requiring a DEP stormwater permit, which meets the following conditions. A site plan or conditional use review is required. That's, again, that's another point there where I think we ought to be using, after conditional use, the phrase or BPL review. There are, so there's just two places I think those might be necessary to clarify. Under 5.1 and maybe 5.254 first. But I was kind of amazed by the kind of hierarchy that Jen had built into hers with the notion of incidental and non-incidental. Seems to be kind of blurred here. It seems like a lot of things are above the radar, so to speak. And again, I don't know if that's a bad thing or a good thing. I'm just pointing out.
Well, we never even could even have a conversation about incidental and non-incidental without constantly trying to correct ourselves on what we were talking about.
Right. I think the best management practice is going to decide whether you would use a incidental or non-incidental, depending on the scope of your project and who's designing it.
Okay. Yeah, he was kind of poking at that.
You go ahead and throw that in, and you'll never get this passed.
No, I'm not advocating for it being thrown in. I'm just saying, I think he was kind of poking at that under page 7, under 5C, at the top of the page, because he was using some of Jen's terminology. Can we try to shine a little light briefly on what are the criterion for who has to write the plan? What level of
expertise
has to be brought to the plan?
where are we with you trying to get the BPL into this someplace thing? Did we spend the last 10 minutes trying to figure out where it was going to go?
I'm just raising the point.
You're still thinking about it.
No, I'm just raising the point for the board to consider, that's all. It seems to, just to nail that down, it seems to be, it ought to be considered under 5.81, under the first sentence.
Well, if we get a clarification from JT, then we may find that it would follow number three.
And it might also be introduced under 5.254, first dot, whatever the hell you call that thing, starting with a site plan review or conditional use review is required. But the one thing we were going to try to think about in between the last meeting and this meeting was 5.81. The question that arises from all of that verbiage is, who's going to write these plans? Maybe Ken is the kind of most best, what kind of credentials the guy would have to do.
JT said it was going to take an expert.
That's where you pulled in the idea of AWAR and the Lake Association on an as-needed basis for their expertise. But we have to have a criterion there for the level of disturbance that would be eligible for that lower level of expertise, so to speak, you know, without an engineering seal. And I don't know if we've just been poking at that and haven't really tied it down. And that gets back to my confusion as to JT doesn't clearly mark for me a hierarchy of permitting and or requirements for review, etc. You know, a lower echelon and a higher echelon of stuff that would lead you to an easy answer of who has to write the plan. Can somebody like from the Lake Association who has training and an accreditation of some sort?
Well, I think JT was pretty adamant that these plans need to be, that the information that you need to resort to come up with the calculations for these plans, it didn't matter how small it was, I think from his point of view. And I think I can, I don't know if I can find it in my notes.
No, I remember him saying that too.
He was basically saying there wasn't an easy do-it-yourself approach.
Unless it was an engineer or related to an engineer.
Yeah, which is probably why I ended up with the BPL. Even though I built my house 15 years ago. But.
Kenny had introduced the idea of maybe trying to talk to, once we had refined our own thinking, talk to Linda Shire and the folks from the Mawson Lake Region Association that does the corollary to AWOR work. The little remediation projects that they do through the summer. I'm not sure as to what level of expertise those drawings are subject to. I guess a lot of them went through Joe Anderson, who New York County saw the water. And the more technical ones, those probably would have been looked at maybe by an engineer. They have an engineer in-house. But I'm not seeing a place where we can draw a line in the sand and say,
well, they're not constructing driveways, and I mean, they're fixing up pieces of shoreline, right? Mostly?
Well, they do erosion control stuff, you know.
I'm sure they could install a rain garden.
Yeah, they used to do that.
I mean, maybe some of the
a modern
simple
one?
Things that.
Because they've changed.
It's right in here.
Rain gardens have changed.
I mean, the homeowner could do it, but we want something a little more substantiated as evidence that this has been done, and so.
Well, we want to know that the rain garden he's going to put in is going to do the job it's supposed to do. And
yeah.
To be able to know that, you've got to.
Sure.
You've got all kinds of stuff you have to look at.
I'm in favor of the engineer, but it's going to cost people more for just a wicked small project. So
it is.
I mean,
that's
what this thing is, though. This isn't some easy, simple thing that, you know, anybody can you know, come in with your building permit on a sheet of paper, give it to Ken, and my God, you get a permit. Of course, you can't do that anymore. You used to be able to. But this kind of stuff, the nature of it, to make sure that it works, you're going to need some kind of expertise way above a layman. Now, whether it needs to be a you know, a PE or, you know, the guy from Soil and Water, what kind of training does he have? What kind of license does he have?
I'm not sure what. He just got his master's, but I'm not sure what it was in.
Is he still available, you know? I never talked to him.
I haven't talked to him for a little while.
Is JT still in the office?
I haven't talked to him either since the day you've seen him.
He left a message on my machine the other day indicating that he's still there 3 days a week. Mm-hmm.
That's what I had heard.
Yeah.
Well, maybe we should try to find out from him what he thinks.
Could we ask him three questions? One is, could he direct us in his draft ordinance to where he's delineating different levels of disturbance and or necessity for review? And or different levels of review that are necessary.
All right, who understood this? Who wrote that down?
I don't know, I haven't read
this. All right, give me number two then.
Number two is,
based upon the level of review necessary, is there a means to have a lower intensity plan developed versus an engineered plan? Is there a means by which we can be less have a less burdensome requirement for the plan, but still have it be a meaningful design? Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know who between Kenny and somebody like Joe Anderson, if something was lifted out of this LID manual and literally Xeroxed and fit to the site somehow and submitted to Ken with Joe Anderson's approval, saying if installed properly, this design is applicable to this site. For a simple procedure, I would think we could be all right with that.
Got you. All right, that's two. What's three?
Any direction for us on post-development maintenance? Means of that doesn't occur.
Follow through. What's the follow through?
Yeah.
Can we just ask about the New Durham?
Just read the thing. Read the New Durham. Read the article about O&M.
Is that, do we all have that?
Yes. Well, you should. Somebody should.
Yeah, I'm sure. I have that somewhere.
You got it somewhere. But read that.
Is there anything else we should ask him?
Clarification
numbers. We asked him about that last one, yeah. And he came back with a printout saying that
he told us it was in here, and it's not.
He was talking about Bar Harbor and it being a mess, to police that.
Maintenance plans, or look in the LID manual, and there's nothing in there. It tells you what needs to be done. It doesn't tell you how to implement it. Vis-a-vis the municipality.
I think he's just said that they shall if they need to.
He said
I thought the performance guarantees is what was screwing him up. If we were going to set something aside to...
Yeah, he didn't like the bonds at all.
Right. Which we really can't do, because who's going to know how much money? And there again, it's got to be there for a million damn years. So, jeez.
Would it be worth that while? Should we just ask him this, or is it worth that while to have him come in for a half an hour to build this thing?
I'll have Brenda ask him some of these questions, and then we also want to get this paragraph, number three. You know, what exactly, is there a typo? What exactly is it? Is it a list?
All right.
Or are they all part of on page five?
Oh, yeah.
And if we're going to put the best possible location in this ordinance, where would be the best spot to place it?
What's the grammatical question you're asking him?
What exactly? I want a better description of the part three there. What is there? Should there be a semicolon? Is there a typo? Is blah blah frickin' blah?
What you're asking is basically, activities listed in the first phrase of 5.253.
Right. Need a permit.
Are those? You know this grammar talk. I don't know this. You want to know if the phrase requiring a DEP stormwater permit is applicable to all those initial activities.
Right. The way it looks, I don't think it is. Now, if it's supposed to be, then we'll have to fix it.
I think it reads very clearly.
Well, you think wrong. Like I said, you don't know the grammar.
It's kind of grouped together in a way that doesn't, it's hard to figure out the pattern of that.
Right.
And it's about three sentences squished into one.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, it's a little bit too run on, but I'll find out exactly what he meant.
You ought to talk to him. Somebody ought to talk to him.
Well, we're going to have it taken care of.
Yeah, but he's going to give us a sentence that we can't even understand.
No, he's not. No, he's not. No, he's not. No, he's not. We'll be fine. So what else?
I'm really adjourned.
This sheet here is the one that he sent back to us dealing with the...
Yeah, bonds. I was looking for that.
You know, the performance bond, the maintenance bonds, and saying basically that the places only have it for a couple of years on the maintenance thing, and then it falls back to the town. I mean, nothing is clear cut, apparently, anywhere.
What do you mean?
What's too clear cut as far as what you do for the long term?
Oh, yes, right. Well, because, again, this is kind of a new thing, and, you know, and you really can't require some homeowner to set aside money for 5 years, 50 years, 100 years.
In New York City, you're liable for your front stoops and your front sidewalks. You have to, if someone comes and tells you, you got to fix those two slabs in front of your, on that stretch of sidewalk, even though millions of people walk it every day.
Right.
You have to fix it.
Right.
So, I mean, that's how they operate. They operate by, when the time comes, you pay for it, whether we have to tell you to do it or not.
Well, that's what New Durham says. I mean,
if you haven't maintained this,
and we've given you warning, then we're going to fix it, and you're going to pay for it. And if you don't pay it right now, then we're going to place a lien. And we place liens on people's properties. It's nothing that, you know, we do this stuff.
There too.
What's your take on
that? I was
fine. I don't think... without going through a court and getting a court order, we'd be able to do the liens and all that.
I don't know.
I mean, we could do it for tax and stuff like that. The law clearly allows you for
It might for something like this, or it's, you know, I don't know.
Well, we can find out the legal, see what, with that thinking in mind.
Well, it's the same thing with people that don't pay the fees or people that accrue fines. We have to take them to court before we can collect. But, you know, some of these things may be worth enough money that we would take them to court.
Yeah.
And they have to pay the freaking court fees as well. So, just because you got to take somebody to court to get your money, doesn't mean we should, otherwise, then there's no point even bothering them with this, because no one's going to do it, because they don't have to. So, yeah, we'll get the money.
Great for you to try. Maybe, I don't know, maybe there's some landscape company that's been doing this stuff that can tell us what it's been doing.
I'm sure there is.
I know like Norpine up in, I can't remember where they are, they're up in Carabas Valley, they're not going to drive down here, but I know that in the winter, Mrs. Norpine, I forget their last name, does go around and speak to garden groups and to road associations and to lake associations and they're very active.
Well, haven't you run into any of these landscaping groups along the coast that you know, haven't you run into companies that are doing...
Associations?
No.
Somebody
landscape companies that take care of, that maintain some of these things.
Yeah. Well, I haven't worked with any that are doing the new big constructions.
But you would know which companies would be involved though, or no?
Not specifically, you can find out pretty quick.
Well, good, that's your project, by the way.
Well, I mean, you can look at, you can call Salmon Falls Nursery, I'm sure they're certified for a lot of stuff. They're one of the biggest construction companies around.
Really?
They travel.
The other one is, another one is known. I don't know if Carter would do it, but between Nome and Salmon Falls, I mean, they're big companies that advertise stuff. They work, they tend, you know, I don't know if they're always general contractor on the big sites, or, you know, there's always multiple, they don't do pave, they don't do their own paving, but they have their own stone guys, they have their own.
Right, and they do the designs for these things, huh?
They work with a network of other companies, you know, there's always, everyone's got their favorite contractors, just like.
I got a quick question. Did between Arthur's point about small projects and the fees, your point was on a very small project that had a fee of $70, it wouldn't be worth charging the guy an additional $7, an additional 10%, is that correct?
Well, yeah, if you look at the time that the code enforcement officer's gonna have to put in reviewing a project, going out to the site to see it all, you know, all that stuff, I think there ought to be a minimum fee, and probably to be $100 makes a lot of sense. And then you can incrementally, depending on what's involved.
If it's a bigger deal, yeah.
Okay.
That would be my, I mean, if you go with the 10%, you might get into fees that aren't enough to cover the expenses of the review and the site visit.
I think I'd get an inclination of what we think it's gonna cost and leave the fees up to the selectmen. They may figure out that it's a, the whole community, the whole town benefits from it and brings up the fees and suck it up. Or implement fees as a user fee and offset the revenue.
Well, that's true.
They do say twofold thing. So there's equity between shorefront property owners and those of us who benefit from their
offset
good maintenance.
Yeah.
But it's a bit of our individual tax bills that we're willing to kick into the for the benefit of good healthy lakes, so that we're all sharing the burden. But the user, when you use the term user fee, I like that because it points out we all use the lakes, but we all know benefit from being shorefront property owners. So this should, again, to have some equity in that equation, I think. It's nice to have the burden shared between shoreland and general purpose district, call it what you want. But I think the user fee notion kind of leads me to believe in more what Arthur's trying to do.
Subsidize half, three quarters of the additional costs.
Well, the on-site property improvements that are necessary to maintain good lake health ought to be the majority of that burden ought to be shouldered by the applicant, the lakefront, shoreline owner. And then the ongoing maintenance costs, everybody kicks into that. I mean, I think this.
No, the maintenance costs still fall on the landowner. Yeah, but the review or the checking to be sure the maintenance is getting done.
Okay. Mm-hmm. However,
right. Well,
that's where you and I, as inland property owners, are willing to help carry the burden because we all.
And how are we going to do that?
Through the levying of an additional line item.
To be a line item in the budget
in
for
Kenny's budget. So there's a twofold.
Yes, but how is the money going to how is the money going to come from my pocket?
Because in
to go into there. How do I get assessed this through what?
When you raise your hand at town meeting to support that line item.
So it's coming from our taxes.
Yes.
Then.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
It would be anyways. It's going to come out of your taxes, and then the revenue would be generated the following year to offset.
Right, no, I was thinking if there was some kind of a...
revolving.
At one time, we talked about a fee that everybody would pay on their, on a building permit, you know, that would go into this fund. But if you just, if you just take it out of taxes, all right, I got you.
Yes, because we have trouble establishing a fund.
Right, because it would just be people getting building permits that would be paying into it. Got you.
Brendan, get on that.
It's on the video.
I took some notes.